Hi, welcome back. In the last video, in the first and second chapter, we went over the first four out of seven churches. And in this video, we'll be covering chapter three, where the last three remain. But you'll notice in this video that we'll be going over one particular church in greater detail. All right, let's get this thing started. We'll be doing a brief breakdown starting now. Here are some of the topics that we'll be covering today. So here are some reasons why I'm teaching a book of Revelation. We're currently in the third seal as of August of 2023. Many people do not believe that we are in the book of Revelation. Many hold the preterist view, saying that we went through all this, we're just waiting for Jesus' return. And then there are some who say, this could be 50 years in the future. What does that have to do with me? And I blame it on the preachers and the teachers that are not teaching the word of God properly or at all. They're teaching a different gospel and they're teaching a different Jesus. We are in a famine of hearing the word of the Lord, according to Amos 8 verses 11 through 12. And I read, behold, the days come, saith the Lord God, that I will send a famine in the land, not a famine of bread, nor a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. And they shall wander from sea to sea, and from the north even to the east. They shall run to and fro to seek the word of the Lord and shall not find it. That's a dire situation to be in. It does not sound pleasing at all to me, and I'm pretty sure you feel the same way. As you see as well, there are way too many false prophets out here. They're the ones preaching a different Jesus and a different gospel, and they're going to be cursed. So that's why we need to study the written word of God to get his word now while he can be found. The Holy Spirit let me know, in addition to myself, I'm currently working on getting out of this status. It's a very difficult task, mind you. Most Christians are lukewarm and will not make it to eternal life at this point. Unless we repent, we're not going to make it. That's basically the gist of it. And Jesus had mercy to alert me of how I needed to correct my Christian walk, obey God's will for my life, and do the Great Commission, according to Matt 28. So we first start with the fifth church out of the seventh church, the dead church. This is a church in Sardis. And I quote from verse 1, I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and art dead. This church has a reputation for being Christians. They are all holy, holy. They're devout Christians, but inwardly, spiritually, they are heathens. They are the walking dead. And we're not talking physical. We're talking spiritual. The Holy Spirit gave me an idea while I was reading. The difference between walking in the spirit versus walking in the flesh. He has been talking to me about that. And it's a daily fight. We fight against our flesh because our flesh battles against our spirit. But that's not the case for these people, right? They're not born again, and therefore they can't even walk in the spirit because they don't have the Holy Spirit anyway. Romans 10:9 basically says, if we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and we believe in our heart that God has raised him from the dead, we shall be saved. So they have a heart issue that deals with the belief in Jesus. And I've listed below many passages that talk about how the spirit gives life and how the flesh gives death. What happens when our physical bodies die? We go to the grave. Our spiritual bodies go to the grave as well, and it's called hell for eternity. Jesus Jesus, in verse 2, tells them to be watchful for him and continue working out their salvation with fear and trembling, and their sins, which are ready to die. In verse 3, he reminds them to remember what he told them and to keep going in what they're doing, to hold fast, was what he said, actually, and to repent. He will come like a thief. In verse 4, there are some people that are sanctified already. Their works fit the standard, and Jesus lets them know that. He doesn't leave them hanging. And they are saved at that moment of time of his analysis. So in verse 5, I quote, "He that cometh, overcometh." Well, how do we overcome in the biblical text way? Well, 1 John 5, verses 4 and 5 tells us what it means. To overcome means to be born of God by believing and having faith that Jesus is the Son of God. Born of God. Remember Jesus telling Nicodemus that no one can enter the kingdom of heaven without being born again. Be born again. Here we go on to the faithful church, which is also called the Church of Philadelphia. Verse 8. There are some key phrases that the Holy Spirit has brought to my attention. Open door, a little strength. Kept my word, not denied my name. As I showed you in last video, I have a King James Bible online website that I go in quote unquote Google search Bible verse phrases, and they help me to connect the dots to what the book of Revelation is saying, because it is full of similes, allusions, and allegories, and the rest of the Bible paints a picture of that. So we, by these verses I have listed on the screen here, we know that they are not workers of iniquity. They have a strength, not in a physical sense, but in a figurative sense, spiritual strength. And these people, they have refrained from evil by obeying Jesus' commandments. And right now, we're going to take a look at some verses that say, deny my name. So I'm going to go over two. There are many more to cover, but I'm just going to save time here. Matthew chapter 10, verses 33 says, "But whosoever shall deny me before men, him will I also deny before my Father, which is in heaven." 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 12, "If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us." Well, that's not a great sign if we deny him. Verse 9, this is the first of two passages that Jesus talks about the synagogue of Satan. And I noticed a pattern. He does not talk about the synagogue of Satan with the churches that he tells to repent or that their works do not make the cut. He talks about the synagogue of Satan with the two true churches that are actually saved at that point of time. So in this verse, Jesus will make the synagogue of Satan, which are by deduction, fake Christians, worship the true Christians, and they will know that God and Jesus love the true ones all along. While we're on this earth, there will be many fake Christians that believe that the persecution and the maltreatment of the true Christians are based on our lack of faith in God and Jesus have left us. But in reality, Jesus is going to turn the tables and let them know the truth in the end. Verse 10, word of my patience, our temptation. So these many scriptures I have listed on the screen refer to patience and temptation. Patience with trials and tribulations. One of the fruits of the Holy Spirit listed in Galatians 5 is called long-suffering. We are supposed to endure until the end, regardless of whatever trials and temptations may come our way. And we are supposed to have patience through all that. Revelation chapter 13, verse 10, and chapter 14, verse 12, says to have faith, obey commandments, and endure until the end. As I said before, patience is God's character and a fruit of the Holy Spirit. There are some other verses here that refer to temptation. And 1 Peter chapter 1, and specifically, and also 1 Peter chapter 4, talks about the trial of faith in the hour of temptation. The hour of temptation is during the Great Tribulation, which is to come soon. God does allow Satan to tempt and attack people to test faith. I want to remind people that this is not a time of wrath. The wrath of God comes after the Great Tribulation and at the day of the Lord when Jesus returns to pour out God's wrath upon the wicked and the false Christians. There are many instances in the Bible where God allows Satan and his satanic kingdom to attack people, to tempt people, to test our faith. Jesus was tempted. Our servant is not greater than his or her master. The Israelites, they were tempted all the time. The biggest test of faith was in 40 years in the wilderness, and we saw how that went. And Job literally went through hell on earth, but guess what? He had patience during his trial of faith. He had patience during his hour of temptation. And guess what? God blessed him with wealth. But now our wealth comes in heaven. So look at these examples and see how this is all going to play out during the end times we'll experience. Now, here are some key points that the Holy Spirit helped me to understand. Now, a lot of Christians believe that the Church of Philadelphia are going to be raptured out. Well, okay, Jesus did say he was going to keep this church out of the hour of temptation. But let's go a little bit deeper. Let's think about what's happened in the Bible of God's chosen when they were going through suffering, trials, and tribulations. We see that they are not raptured out. They were not taken off the earth. They are not taken off the earth to avoid the Great Tribulation. Everyone will be going through it. This is a worldwide test to see who truly wants to be on the A team, the winning team, the Jesus team, the God team. Who's going to really go through the mud to make it to paradise? Survival of the fittest. Not the physical fittest, but the spiritually fittest. They are kept from God's tribulation / test of faith on earth. That means they will not be raptured out and will endure until the end of the age or life, whichever comes first. We never know when our time's up. Only God knows that time. We know that their faith is already strong and they don't need fiery trials to strengthen it. But if they, let's say they were to not hold fast to what they're already doing and they decide to fall off the track, then that's when their trials and tribulations may come and God will test their faith. But let's say they continue and endure to the end of life or the age. Well, they don't need fiery trials to strengthen it. God will not allow much suffering to happen to them, or if any at all, until persecution and martyrdom time. This time is when the Antichrist rolls on the scene and starts slaughtering Christians like Hitler did the Jews. The two main people that came to mind, thanks to the Holy Spirit, Noah and Lot. Judgment rained down from heaven. First, by water, right? Noah was talking about, hey, man, we got to get ready. He was preaching. And, you know, they flooded the earth. And then Lot witnessed the fire and brimstone of Sodom and Gomorrah, which is what we're going to be witnessing. Well, not witnessing. We'll be seeing it happening on earth when Jesus returns. You can read Malachi 4 to get a general idea of how fire will be poured down by Jesus. So these two men, they were not affected by the judgments that were happening to the wicked. They were just, well, Noah went into a huge boat, right? A huge ark. And Lot basically went to another city where he wasn't burned up. And when God saw that Noah was safe in the boat and God shut the doors, and when God saw that Lot had obeyed him and basically was out of the city, he made it rain. The first time, actual rain, and the second time, fire. And they still lived on earth while it happened. They went through the storm. They went through the rainstorm. They went through the firestorm while this happened. And they did not die. They did not receive the judgment, the wrath of God. So this is the Luke church, the lukewarm church, the church of the Laodiceans. And I quote from verse 15, "I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot." I've been convicted of this because I haven't been totally committed to Jesus. And I'm sorry to say that, but I have to be honest. So I hope that my rebuke will help you grow as well. In verse 16, Jesus says that he finds us disgusting enough to vomit. That's not a great thing. And I'm going to go to Job chapter 20, verse 15, actually. I'm going to go down to 15. And it says, "He hath swallowed down riches, and he shall vomit them up again. God shall cast him out of his belly." That kind of gave me an idea of what being lukewarm is, in addition to how much God hates that. So if you are part of this church, we have to repent. We have to seek Jesus while he can be found, and we need to develop a relationship with him to see where are some areas that we are falling short in and how we can fix them before our names be blotted out of the book of life. So this church is materially wealthy and are hypocrites. They may be Christian on the outside, just like the dead church. But the difference between the dead church and the lukewarm church is the lukewarm church are born again. They have the gift of the Holy Spirit, right? They're not spiritually dead, as in not having the Holy Spirit, but spiritually wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. It does not mean a lack of money. It means spiritually these things. And one of the things that the Holy Spirit brought to my mind is Pharisee mentality. Members of this church have a lot of pride, arrogance. They are generally unaware of the sins that they have, and they feel like they have no need to repent. They are in the flesh, deep in the flesh, very worldly, so worldly that an unbeliever cannot tell that they are Christian. And they are not led by the anointing of the Holy Spirit. They are not being led by the Spirit. So I'm going to break down some of these words that I meant that I saw in the verse 17 reading. And wretched is also listed in Romans chapter 7, verse 24 as well. And you can read that on your own. Paul basically talks about the law, flesh, carnality, and sin in the entire chapter, if you want to read for context. So wretched in this case means carnal, fleshly, and of course, sinful. Miserable is also listed in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 19. And with that conclusion, without Christ and his divine hope, we are miserable due to our sins. We have no hope without him, because we're going to hell basically without him. And that's eternal misery. And poor. And as you see in the book of Revelation, this is in a spiritual, not literal sense. As I was reading this, the Holy Spirit reminded us of the phrase morally bankrupt. You can actually look up the definition, and that's the lukewarm church, lukewarm Christians. And I'm quoting Psalms 69, verse 29. But I am poor and sorrowful. Let thy salvation, O God, set me up on high. So only God, through Jesus, can give us hope, because he provides salvation. And poor means sinful and not saved in this case. Verse 17 also has blind. I'm quoting John chapter 9, verse 41. Jesus said unto them, if ye were blind, ye should have no sin. But now ye say, we see, therefore your sin remaineth. So basically they were said, oh, in the flesh, we see what you're talking about. But Jesus says they're blind. But since they said they see what he's talking about, their sin remains. See, they were seeing him in a flesh by the letter sense, but they did not see him spiritually. Therefore, you cannot see spiritually if you do not have the spirit. So they died in their sins. In Matthew chapter 23, verse 17, Jesus basically calls the Pharisees blind when talking about gold. And I will go to that chapter right now to read that word for word. Wait just a moment while I get to there. Verse 17 says, ye fools and blind, for whether is greater, the gold or the temple that sanctifieth the gold? And again, it will be helpful if you read Matthew 23 in context to get a full picture. But that's what a lukewarm Christian is. Jesus also talks about naked in verse 17. In many, many Bible verses, you'll read and figure out that nakedness is associated with shame. And shame is equated to sin, wickedness, and unrighteousness. And everlasting shame, you die in your sin, you die in your wickedness, and you die in your unrighteousness, hypothetically. Verse 18 says, buy of me gold tried in the fire. So Jesus wants an exchange here. Well, we saw in Matthew 23:17 that God basically was telling that the Pharisees were blind when asking about gold. Well, Jesus is talking about gold here, right? Well, the physical gold. They were spiritually blind because they kept looking at the physical gold, but he was talking about the spiritual gold, the gold tried in the fire. 1 Peter 1:7 talks about the trial of faith tried by fire is more precious than literal gold that will perish. This is spiritual gold. Jesus says in exchange for fire-tried faith, he will give spiritual gold that will never pass away. Cha-ching! So instead of chasing the earthly bag, we need to chase the spiritual bag that Jesus provides. We need to chase those crowns of life instead of, well, money that's going to burn up in the fire. He talks about verse 18, clothes. In many Bible verses, again, being clothed means being made righteous by God, Jesus, with no shame or sin. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 3 says, if so be that being clothed, we shall not be found naked. So that means if you have clothes, and clothes, no clothes means you're naked. Naked means sin. That means we are righteous. Being clothed is being righteous. Verse 18 says, anoint thine eyes with eye salve that thou mayest see. In John chapter 9, verse 6, Jesus anointed a blind man's eyes with clay. He basically spit into the clay, mixed it up, and put it over a blind man's eyes. That was a symbolism, physical symbolism of Jesus opening spiritual eyes with the anointing of his Holy Spirit. Jesus anoints us with his Holy Spirit when we truly believe in him with our heart. That's what marks you as a Christian. That's what marks you as a child of God. John 10, 21 tells us that the devil is unable to do this. The devil blinds people. The devil cannot do what Jesus does because guess what? He's Antichrist. So do you remember Balaam from the last video? He was a true prophet, but he was corrupt. Numbers 24:3 says his eyes were open. He was anointed with the Spirit of God. But unfortunately, he used his anointing for the devil. He tried to make Israel do evil in the sight of God. But God would not allow him to curse Israel. So keep that in mind. Those of us who are anointed with God's Holy Spirit and spiritual gifts, we are supposed to use them for God. Not use them for sometimes for God, but when you feel like it, use it for the world. I was guilty of this. But, you know, I'm changing my ways, and I hope you do as well. Verse 19, I love, I rebuke, and chasten. And then there's another phrase, be zealous. In Hebrews chapter 12, verses 5 through 10, for whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. In that passage, verses 5 through 10, it gives context about who is the Lord's and who does he chasten, right? He's not going to allow you to sin willy-nilly forever. He's going to give you some punishment, some trials that go against you, not for you. He will not bless you. Remember Deuteronomy 28. There are curses for disobedience and blessings for obedience. It's the same idea. Romans chapter 8, verse 14. For as many are as led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. John 1:12 says, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. So these are some verses that back up who are the people of God. And, you know, in this chapter, Revelation 3, God chastens lukewarm Christians. So that gave me a clue that these are born-again Christians who are being disobedient. The faith is there, but the obedience is not there. The obedience is sometimes there, but the obedience is not 100%. God requires 100% faithfulness, just like as he is faithful to us. We're not going to be faithful 100% of the time, but with Jesus, through God's eyes, we are 100% faithful by abiding in him, according to John 15. And he chastens us to inspire us to zeal and repentance. One of the ways that God's chastened me is basically allow things that he's blessed in the past to fall apart. If you were blessed with a good income and you've been disobedient, we'll let some income fall through the cracks and you'll end up either homeless or close to being homeless and not in a blessed state. That's my personal testimony about being chastened. And of course, you're not going to want to be in that state very long. As I did, I started asking God, well, what do you want me to do? I'm still not wanting to do this thing you want me to do, but I'm willing to learn and help me to grow into doing this. And Jesus has helped me to grow into putting myself out there online and basically spreading the gospel on the internet. It's very easy to talk with people in person, but online I tend to get very nervous and stutter a lot. So bear with me as I go through this series. Psalm 119, verse 139. My zeal hath consumed me, because mine enemies have forgotten thy words. So David is a speaker here. David is so on fire for God. He is sold out for God that he's angry because his enemies have forgotten God's commandments. And we should be on that level with the world. We should not. I was teaming up with people who were obviously against God, who were obviously antichrist. And I thought maybe I can befriend this person, this lady, and, you know, maybe I can change her, right? But Jesus let me know that that's God's job, to change hearts through his Holy Spirit. I'm supposed to be spreading the word, not growing people spiritually. That's God's job. In addition to that, I think it's in a book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Basically says, bad company corrupts good morals. The more you hang out with the unbelievers, the unsaved, instead of me changing them, we will be changed for the worse. So that's why we must have that zeal. We must have that on fire passion for God enough to be obedient, to be obedient. David was a man after God's own heart. So he is an awesome example of being zealous for God and Jesus. We should be looking at God with admiration, fear, which is not just emotion. It's not emotional fear. It's, in this case, fear means reverence and respect for God's sovereignty, respect for Jesus' sovereignty. Even though I have the screen up, I'm going to go ahead and talk more on lukewarm Christianity. But I'm going to quote the scripture and then talk more on lukewarm Christianity as well. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me. Jesus says this in Revelation chapter 3, verse 20. So, more about lukewarm Christianity. Jesus is knocking on my door and your door for him to come in to sup with us. That basically, he is calling us to be friends with him, not frenemies as we are, because that's what we are. When we try to walk with the world and walk with Jesus, we become his frenemy. We're friends with him sometime, but we're friends with the devil sometime as well. We can't do that. And fighting the flesh is a difficult thing. Paul had this issue in the book of Romans. He's talking about, you know, he continues to do the things he does not want to do, even though he knows not to do them. And it's the same situation with me. And I assume that's the same situation with you when walking in the flesh versus the spirit, because there are some times where God has called me to fast and, you know, I'm like, I'll fast, you know, and then I'll end up breaking my fast because I get hungry or forget, or I'll fast for part of the time period and go half in. It's dragging. It's like going through the motions the second part of the period. That's no way to live. And God does not want us to live that way. He'll actually vomit us out at judgment day. Lukewarm Christians, even though we're anointed by the Holy Spirit, but through disobedience, we will go to hell. He is very adamant about this, and I cannot stress this enough. We need to develop a relationship according to Revelation 3:20 with Jesus, and that will set us free. In addition to that, a lot of us have idols. Idolatry is a big thing with me. There are things where I spend a lot more time. I spend a lot more time on the internet, just basically scrolling on TikTok, maybe YouTube too. Just scrolling, like scrolling a day away. And that's a deep issue I'm trying to get rid of with Jesus. That is a process, but do not feel bad, because Jesus is the solution. Jesus is the answer. Jesus would not let you sit there and struggle without him telling you the solution. Now, if we disobey, that's on us. We send ourselves to hell by our disobedience. But Jesus says, when we answer the door, when we hear his voice, he will come into us and sup with us, and we will be with him. So that means he's willing to work with you if we, he's willing to work with us if we work with him. And another thing about idolatry, this is about Americans specifically, because the most of us that claim that we're Christian are lukewarm and are headed to hell. Some of us idolized Obama, Hillary, Joe Biden, the Democrats, right? And some of us idolize, I'm just going to say it, Donald Trump. Donald Trump has been the most popular Republican president in ages. And a lot of Christians, self-proclaiming Christians, were saying that they were hearing from the word, they were hearing the word of the Lord. And they turned out to be false because Joe Biden won in 2020. So God allowed Satan to put up presidents like Barack Obama and Donald Trump to test people. And of course, I failed. And those of you who supported Trump failed as well. So politics is a huge source of idolatry in America, and the Lord really wants to speak on that. And I'm just relaying the message to you. These are workers of Satan. Every single president that we voted in has been a worker of Satan, because the God of this world, the ruler of this world, is the devil and will be until Jesus Christ comes back to set up God's kingdom on earth. So if you are a huge political Christian, it's time for us to stop. I've stopped once I found out that the elections were rigged by the Holy Spirit, and that most of the presidents are the seed of Satan, both physically and spiritually. I stopped voting. I refuse to vote in any other governmental election, and just decide to focus on my spiritual growth and help spreading the gospel to others. But hear the Spirit of the Lord. Stop idolizing politicians and celebrities. And if you don't know what idolatry is, well, go into the Bible. It's not about worshiping false gods. It's about worshiping things, material things. I had issues with chasing the bag. That is worshiping money. I had issues with scrolling on the internet, taking up most of my day. That is worshiping the internet, my phone. Anything we spend more time on versus God, we are committing idolatry. So rest assured, Jesus will work with you if you answer his call. This wraps up this presentation. Thank you. Hi, did you like the video? Then don't hesitate to hit the like, subscribe buttons, and hit the bell icon. Make sure you leave a comment. Do you have a personal message that the Holy Spirit has given to you and you would like to share with others? Then don't hesitate to comment. But remember, everyone, do not be deceived. Test the spirits, for every spirit is not of God, but can be of Antichrist. All right, stay tuned for more videos. See you next time.